Good evening. My name is Itamar Vilner, and I'm the head of the science division at the Israel Academy of Sciences. And I am really pleased to open this Einstein lecture ceremony. The heritage of Albert Einstein is centered at the Hebrew University of Jerusalem. And as you might be aware, we have the largest archive of Einstein's handwritten letters, papers, and belongings. As you might notice, the Israel Academy of Sciences and Humanities is honoring Einstein's seminal contributions to science. We have in our garden Einstein's statue, and all of our guests are usually taking the picture as a memory of the visit at the Academy of Sciences. We have established the Einstein Lectureship about 16 years ago, and this is another flagship to commemorate Einstein's achievements and contributions to science. We have an annual, this annual lectureship reflects every year a different scientific topic, and the topic is selected by, the lecturer is selected by the members of the Israel Academy of Science. As one may realize, during the years, we have had here many distinguished scientists from the entire world, and many of the Nobel laureates are Einstein's lecturers during the year. This year, we dedicated the Einstein lecture to the area of neuroscience and neurocomputations. And we are glad and privileged to have as the lecturer, Nobel laureate Professor Edvard Moser from the Norwegian University of Science and Technology in Trondheim, Norway. I am confident that we will have an exciting and stimulating lecture today. Before continuing with the Einstein lecture ceremony, I would like to use this opportunity and congratulate two of our Academy members, Professor Yossi Yarden, who won the Israel Prize in Biology, and Professor Nili Cohen, President of the Academy of Science, who won the Israel Prize in the law discipline. I really thank all of you for joining us for this evening, and I would like to invite to have some introductory words Professor Nili to give her greetings.
Thank you very much, Itamar. Dear friends and colleagues, our distinguished Albert Einstein Memorial Lecturer, Professor Moser. I'm happy to open the Albert Einstein Memorial Lecture, one of the two distinguished lectures we hold here at the Israel Academy of Sciences and Humanities. The other lecture is the Martin Buber Memorial Lecture, which is being held at the Humanities section. I'm delighted this evening for two reasons. The first is the very existence of such a lecture. As we all know, Albert Einstein marks not only the utmost excellence in science, it also denotes commitment to liberal values and to humanity at large. The second reason for my delight is Professor Edvard Moser, a Nobel laureate a mark of utmost scientific excellence and of devotion to social welfare. Thank you, Professor Moser, our dear guest and Einstein speaker. We are thrilled with your scientific accomplishments and social commitment. And I call upon, again, my dear colleague, Professor Itamar Vilner, head of the sciences section at the Academy, to go on with the ceremony. Thank you.
Thank you.
Only to give you the list of what we expect to have here during the ceremony, our next introducer will be Professor Ullmann, who will introduce the speaker. Afterwards, Professor Moser will give his talk. And at the end, I would like to ask our guests to stay here because we donate Professor Moser with a medal, the Einstein medal, and the scroll of the lectureship. So I would like to invite Shimon, please, to introduce the speaker.
Good evening. It's a pleasure to welcome and to introduce Professor Edward Moser, who will deliver the 2017 Einstein Memorial Lecture of the Israeli Academy of Sciences Humanities. We are going to hear from him about his seminal discoveries of mechanisms in the mammalian brain responsible for positioning and navigation in space. These are fascinating discoveries about a fundamental domain in science, and it is very fitting that this presentation takes place in the framework of the Thank you. I think it's very fitting that this presentation by Professor Moser takes place in the framework of the Einstein lecture. It is safe to assume that Einstein would have been very interested in tonight's presentation because there is a fundamental connection between the interests of Einstein and those of Moser, which is the notion of space. Space is, of course, one of the most basic aspects of physics to which Einstein made his seminal and original contributions. But space is also a fundamental aspect of cognition and of the function of the brain in humans and in other animals. Dealing with space, positioning and navigation is a major task of the brain throughout the entire animal kingdom. Even simpler animals have amazing spatial capabilities, such as the, for example, the Sahara Desert ants, which they measure long distances by actually counting the steps they make along the way, or the monarch butterfly that can navigate all the way from Mexico to Canada and find its over thousands of kilometers and finding the right way to its destination. The mammalian brains, including the rat and human brain, which Moser studied, have similarly evolved sophisticated and complex mechanisms for positioning and navigation. Because the problem of spatial cognition is so basic and so old in brain development, it appears that other cognitive systems may have used foundations laid by spatial cognition for other tasks. For humans, as noted by Immanuel Kant, the notion of space provides a basic perspective of the mind to grasp and understand the world in general. As a result, understanding the biological foundations of spatial cognition at the level elucidated by Moser's work can offer a path to understanding other aspects of cognition and thinking. The discoveries in the domain of spatial cognition also gives us a unique opportunity to obtain a comprehensive understanding of a complete cognitive domain by combining both the structure and function. Combining the anatomy and physiology of the brain with the computation it performs is a fundamental goal in brain science, but also a very difficult and very elusive one. The discoveries of brain representations using place cells and grid cells that we'll hear about and related mechanisms and the computation they perform is getting us closer to achieving this integrative goal in the brain system, which is responsible for positioning and for navigation. Finally, I think that another common aspect to Einstein's space and to Moser's space is the beauty in their theories. I think it's really rewarding when scientific findings not only discover and explain phenomena, but also do this in a beautiful way. To complete the introduction, here is a brief bio. Edvard Moser obtained his PhD in neurophysiology from the University of Oslo. He then worked for a short period with Richard Morris at the University of Edinburgh, and then with John O'Keefe at UCL. He is currently in the University of Science and Technology in Trondheim, a founding director of the Kavli Institute of Systems Neuroscience and a co-director of the Center of Neural Computation. He received the 2014 Nobel Prize in Physiology or Medicine together with his long-term collaborator, May-Britt Moser, and with John O'Keefe. They got it for their discoveries of cells that constitute a positioning system in the brain. The title of tonight's talk is Grid Cells and Neural Networks for Space. And with this, I'd like to invite Professor Moser to deliver the Einstein's Memorial Talk.
For the kind introduction, and also to the Academy for selecting me for this prestigious lecture, which is something I really appreciate, and especially when looking back at the history and the people who have already been here. So what I would like to do is to share some of the work we are doing in Norway. I will divide it into two parts. So in the first part, I will try to be general and introduce all of you to the field. And then I will gradually transition over to more recent work and in the end some unpublished work, but we'll try to keep it at a level where it's interesting both to the general audience and to people who actually work in the field. So let me then begin with the field. And indeed, the science of space, which includes both neuroscience and psychology, has made quite considerable advances through the last few decades. So in the sense that we are now able to address a number of questions about how we actually perceive and compute space in the brain. So we can actually address questions like whether there are internal maps in our brain that reproduce the external space, whether such maps are generic or specific for certain environments, what the elements are, what kinds of cells work in such a map, whether they are derived from properties of the brain or more an composition of external influences, whether they are innate and how they are used, and so on. So it's quite fascinating, actually, when we know all of this, that the system works so well that we actually find our way in spaces that are even like this, which you probably know quite well in Israel, the deserts, where you have very, very few landmarks, but still, despite the presence of or the lack of landmarks, we are actually extremely good at finding our way and keeping an internal record of where we are relative to other positions and relative to where we were just a few moments ago. So these insights that we are now beginning to have, I mean, there are many reasons for being interested in this. So one is that we want to understand space as such, or how the brain deals with space. But the other reason is perhaps a bit more general, namely that this is one of few areas in neuroscience, in what we call systems neuroscience or behavioral neuroscience, where you can actually be able to get at some of the mechanisms of how the brain, and especially the cortex, works. Because this is accessible, we can actually measure it easily, and we know already quite a lot. So you can get to the workings of the brain, of the cortex, and find principles that then apply much more broadly and will help us in the long run to understand other psychological cognitive functions that are much, much more difficult. So that's the real aim that I think it's a kind of window into the workings of the brain. But then let's go back in time a little bit and focus on space. And the studies of space in many ways started with Edward Tolman, who was a professor at the University of California at Berkeley. So what he suggested is, unlike all the whole rest of psychology at his time, and this was in the 1930s, 40s, 50s, what he suggested is that the way we find our way in space is not just by linking what he called, what they call stimuli and responses, or linking small elements of behavior together. But what he suggested is that in our brain, we actually have internal maps that help us guide or find our way from one place to the other. And he, based on experiments that he did in his lab, he was actually, he made some very specific suggestions, namely that if you have such a map, if you use maps to navigate to find your way, you should, for example, be able to take shortcuts. You should be able to go from one place to another in a way that you have never, ever done before because you have a global picture of how things fit together. So he did experiments like this one. This is a maze for a rat seen from above. So a rat starts here, goes through a central area here, goes through an alley, and finally reaches a goal where there's some food. Does that many, many, many times. And then it is classical experiment. It then starts here again, gets into that central area. But now, on the test day, there are many arms out. And what Tolman finds is that the rat takes the direct path to the goal, a path that it has never taken before. But because it has a map, he reasoned, it goes the shortest way. These experiments were criticized, but that's not really essential. What's essential here is that he introduced the concept of having maps, and it was very controversial for several decades, but he created a new way of thinking. So, but where are these maps in the brain? That was a question that even Tolman himself didn't really want to dig into for very understandable reasons. So what he, like all other experimental psychologists at the time, did was that they considered the brain like a black box. It's called a black box. Then there are inputs, there are outputs, and then they made a psychology by describing how the inputs relate to the output and make predictable relationships, but avoided the inside of the brain. That made sense because there weren't concepts, there were no methods, so it was very hard really to understand how neurons worked in the brain. So this lasted for 30s, 40s, and then the 50s came. Optimism came back, war was over, and things started to change also in science. And neuroscientists began to develop more sophisticated electrodes that made them able to pick up the activity from single neurons in the brain and actually listen to or record the electrical impulses from cells, from neurons, that actually gave rise to behavioral functions. But this is a complicated task. So even if neuroscience began in the 50s and then more in the 60s to record from single neurons in the brain, even in awake animals, the task is extremely challenging because what's inside the brain, this is just a cartoon, of course, very simplified, but it illustrates the complexity of the brain. Namely, in a human brain, approximately 80 to 100 billion neurons, each connected to approximately 10,000 others. Connections are through what we call synapses, where the electrical activity from one neuron on the so-called presynaptic side is causes release of chemicals, neurotransmitters, that go over to the other side and cause a response in the other side. But then imagine just the myriad of connections where such interactions occur. This is where we think the information is stored and operated on in the brain. But when we then know that this is distributed all over the brain, first of all, it's difficult to access it because it's so small. And then, even if you could access it, where to look, because it's all over. So it's a really difficult task, but there are ways to treat it, to handle that. And one of the ways is that neuroscientists mostly work on simpler systems in animals with less complex or at least smaller brains. And when you then go to the average of approximately 86 billion neurons in the human brain, as we go down in macaques, you have about 6 billion, and then in rats, 200 million, in mouse, 71 million. So it gets more manageable, still very, very much, and that's the reason why much of neuroscience actually is done in invertebrates with just some hundred thousands or 10,000 of neurons, or even less. But in mammals, if you focus on mammals, you can actually see, and this is just an illustration of how the cortex is built up in these different, species. The point being that the structure is actually quite similar, and the cortex, for example, is built up in a similar way, so that you don't need to start with the most complex. You can start much simpler. And even if a mouse is very, very complex, it's at least many reasons, not just that it's a smaller brain, but also mice are easier to study. We know you can manipulate genes and so on. So there are many reasons that we actually can get down to the computations of the brain in a manageable manner. So a few years ago, around 1970, John O'Keefe started using these microelectrodes, and he used rats, and recorded from the brain, actually from a brain area called the hippocampus, in the rat brain. So hippocampus in humans is in the temporal lobe, so it's a structure that was mostly known for a role in memory, but this is the same area where O'Keefe started to record activity. This shows a rat or rodent brain. It looks like a sausage underneath the neocortex. And then he put electrodes into this brain area and started to record electrical impulses or action potentials from the brain of awake rats when they were walking around in different types of environments. And what he found is illustrated in the following movie. So you know, going to see a rat. A rat is here, walking around in a box. This is a 1 by 1 meter box. What keeps a rat walking is that there are small sprinkles of chocolate lying around or being thrown out into the box. And the rat really likes chocolate, so it walks around and picks up this. And then for the occasion, the electrodes in the rat's hippocampus are connected to a cable and to a computer so that we can record the action potentials or the electrical impulses from that cell. So let's start the movie. So we are going to listen to the electrical impulses of one particular cell in the hippocampus. And so each time you hear a sound, a pop, then that is when the cell is electrically active. And you will at the same time see some red dots on the screen which illustrate where the rat is when the cell is active. So you can hear the cell being active, firing, as we say. And what you soon will notice is that the cell is only active when the rat is up here. It comes back, very active, and goes away, comes back, goes away, silent, totally silent, comes back, active again, and so on. Of course, this is speeded up a little bit. So what you see here is that the cell has one area in this space where it is active. This is what O'Keefe called the place field of the cell, and he called these cells place cells because they are active only at certain places. And then he found that I can also show it in a different way. I should show that. So this is the same box. Blue is a color-coded, so the blue is low activity, red is high activity here. So what O'Keefe found, together with John Dostrowski in 1971, was that many of the cells are like that, and he found then over the years that actually this is a very common firing property of hippocampal cells, but different place cells are active in different places, so that if this cell is active up here, another cell might be active here, another down here, another down there, and so on. And there are many thousands, 10,000, maybe 100,000 of neurons that have such properties. And of course, if you listen to all those neurons, or even just a small subset of them at the same time, then you can, or if you are a computer, you can tell immediately where the rat is because of the combination of activity. So based on that, O'Keefe and then his colleague, Lynn Nidell, suggested in 1978 that this is an implementation of the cognitive map that Tolman had proposed some 20, 30 years earlier. So that was in the 1970s. And then I'll make a big jump. So a lot was learned about place cells in the 70s, 80s, 90s. But there were some questions that still remained completely puzzling. And those were are questions that I will now address and then start with the work from our lab, which started in 1996, our lab in Trondheim. And so this is a lab that I established together with Maybrit Moser, and all the work is work from that lab. So the question we began with was, how can you, in the middle of the brain, kind of, get a signal that is so specific? So the place cells, they are active at only one place, here, there, or wherever. But still, this is not something that it derives in any simple way from the senses, because you don't have place sensors. There's nothing in the ears or in the eyes or in the nose or whatever that gives you a place signal. So this is something that, to a large extent, is created in the brain. And the hippocampus is as far into the middle of the brain as you can get. It's far away from any particular sensory inputs, many stages before you get there, and it's also far away from the motor outputs. So it's really a nice place to understand what's going on, but still, I mean, how can you get such a specific signal when usually things just start out from the senses and then emerge together, and it often gets more and more diffuse. But in this case, you actually have a signal that's created and very, very clear in this part of the hippocampus. This area here where O'Keefe recorded, for example, is called CA1. So we wanted to understand how that signal arises. And the popular idea at that time, this is in the late 1990s, was that the hippocampus, this sausage here, is a kind of a unidirectional circuit. So if you make a transection through it, then signals come in from the entorhinal cortex here and go through several stages, including CA3 here, and then go to CA1 here, and then go back out to the entorhinal cortex. So a common thought was that the place cell signal was somehow created, or at least amplified, in this circuit here before it came to CA1. So the obvious thing to do was what we did. That was that we started recording here, just like O'Keefe. This is a box. The black trace is where the rat walked in the box seen from above. And each red dot is where the cell was active. So the place field here is in the middle. And then we inactivated or made lesions, took away parts of this internal circuit. So we simply broke the circuit and then predicted that if this is important, well, then that will, of course, disrupt the CA1 place cell signal here. But that was actually not what happened, because this is a slide that shows what happened. So here we have seven different cells, color-coded, seen from the box, same as from above, the same type of box. And what you see is that each of these cells, after disrupting the loop here, still has a pretty clear preferred firing region. Not maybe so nice, as nice as in control animals, but pretty good still. So that suggested that you can actually do quite well without the loop. So that either means that this area here magically creates place cells itself, or, which for many reasons perhaps wasn't so likely, or there is something important coming in through a route that bypasses the area that we disconnected. And there is actually such a route, but it was so understudied at the time that it wasn't part of the standard circuit, so I had to put it in here with a red line. But there is a direct connection coming right in here, and the knowing that the existence of such a direct connection then led us, together with an anatomist, Menno Witter, who we have been working with for 2 decades soon, led us to record in the entorhinal cortex here. And so that's one step up from the hippocampus. And then again, put the rat into the box here and let it again go around, walk and find its chocolate pieces, and then see if it could find any precursor or any signal that could give rise to the place cell signal. And the recordings were made here in, this is in the entorhinal cortex, rat brain seen from behind, and it's a colored area here. And we made the recordings in the area here that has the strongest connections to the part of hippocampus where O'Keefe had made his recordings. So let's look at another movie. Now there's no sound, but there are white dots that show where the cell is active. Again, just a single cell in the entorhinal cortex. And what you can see now is that this cell is active in many places. So it's different from the cell that you saw in the hippocampus. It's not only active in one place, it fires many places. So not very encouraging, perhaps, if you look for a place cell signal. But then, as we let the rat go, you'll see that actually there is some sort of pattern. So these cells have many fields, many areas where they are active. And moreover, those areas actually form some sort of pattern because the distance between these fields is not random. They seem to sort of be as far away from each other as they can. And that turned out to be the case when we used larger environments. So this is now a box that is 220 by 220 centimeters. The gray trace in the background is where the rat walked, and each black dot is where the cell was active, and you can see that it forms a triangular or hexagonal pattern that repeats itself all over the space that the rat covered. And just to help you, I put red lines on top of this diagram for another box, and you can see that it's really a grid consisting of equilateral triangles, or more precisely a hexagon, that repeats itself all over the space. So this was a different type of cell that the hexagonal nature was, of course, not expected at all, but once we see it, it's obvious that it contains metric information. How and whether that is used is still not well known, but the information is clearly there. So then we have two parts of the spatial map, or Tolman's map, that I started out with. So the grid cells come with some different properties, and one of the properties that vary is what we call the phase of the grid, so the XY locations of each grid field. So what you see here is a diagram that illustrates 3 different grid cells. We can imagine 3 different grid cells that were recorded more or less on the same location. This just shows the electrodes that we used to pick up signals below, and 3 different cells close to each other. But what you see is that those 3 example cells are not firing at the same spots. So the phases are shifted apparently quite randomly from each other. And this is the case whenever you record a local cluster within a certain range, you find that the phase is more or less randomly distributed. That may be the case that if you go into even the smaller spaces, then you might actually see some pattern, some relationship, but by and large, this is the case. That's very different from another property of the grid, which is the scale, namely how small are the fields and how close are they. So this is a rat brain seen from the side. This is the hippocampus, and this is the colored area is the entorhinal cortex, medial entorhinal cortex. If you begin recording here at the top, what you see is that the cells have a small scale, so the fields are really close to each other, approximately 30 centimeters away from each other. Then as you go deeper in the brain, then you get cells with larger fields and wider spacing, and this can actually even stretch out probably to several meters in the end. So But what we didn't know in the beginning was whether this actually is there a continuum of maps, a continuous scale that begins with small at the top and goes to big at the bottom, or are there actually multiple discrete maps? And it turns out to be the latter, because some years later, when we were able to record activity from as many as up to 200 grid cells in the same animal, then it turned out that if you plot the size of the grid, or that means in this case the distance between the fields, these are autocorrelograms, but it illustrates the grid pattern in any case. So if you plot the size or the scale of the grid on the y-axis, on the x-axis you have position along this dorsal to, along this top to bottom axis. So top here, bottom far out here. Then, and each cell is one dot here. What you see is that as you start from the top, the scale is small, and then gradually you get more of the larger scales, and then increases and increases. But what you also can see is that it is always in every single animal where you have a decent number of cells, you see that it is a step-like process, meaning that you have one group of cells with a small scale, one other group with a slightly larger scale, and then a third group with a larger scale, a fourth group, and probably a fifth, and then we don't know if there are probably a few more, but that we don't know. So many different maps that are quite discrete. So then, moreover, what was quite fascinating is that there is a non-random relationship between the scale of these maps. So if you call the bottom one here M1, module 1, and then M2, M3, M4, if you divide M2 by M1, or M3 by M2, or M4 by M3, what you find is that it's actually a constant scale factor, so that you just need to multiply by the same factor, in our case 1.42 on average, or let's say 1.4, and you go from the first scale to the second, and from the second to the third, and from the third to the fourth. So it's like in a geometric progression, and the advantage of that still remain to be shown, but there are at least some indications that efficiency of coding a space with a minimum number of cells may perhaps be benefit from such an organization. So to just make sure you don't think that there are only grid cells in the entorhinal cortex, it soon turned out, just a year after the grid cells, that there are also what is called head direction cells. So these are cells that were discovered already in 1985 by Jim Rank in New York. And what he found and what we showed in the entorhinal cortex among the grid cells is that there are also other cells that do not have any particular relationship to location. So you see it's more or less distributed all over. They are in the entorhinal cortex like this. Dots here is where the recordings were made. But what you see to the right here is a plot that shows the firing rate as a function of the direction of the rat's head, so where it's looking. So this particular cell, shown on two different occasions, is active when the rat is looking towards the left or towards the west side here. And this particular cell is active only when the rat is looking up to the top left corner here, and same here, and otherwise completely silent. So it's directional cells, or almost like a compass, that is active only when the rat is in a certain direction, regardless of where it is in the space. So that's another type of cell. And then yet another type of cell, which we described in 2008 in the same network. So these are cells that are active only along boundaries or borders of the local environment. This is a box of the type we saw. And on the right side here, the cell is active, shown by warm colors. The rest of the box, completely silent. And then you can stretch the box, and you still have activity mostly only along that wall. You can stretch it the other way, same thing. And then move the rat into a different room. It fires along now. Now it's active on the left side instead. But then you insert the wall here, and it fires. It's active along that wall too. So yet another type of cell is active along the local borders, and in this case indicates the boundaries of the local environment. It can be a wall, like in this case, but it can also be, if the rat is on the table, it would be the edge. Same thing. And these cells are completely different from grid cells because a grid cell is never a border cell, and a border cell can never become a grid cell. And then finally, in the same network, there are also cells that indicate the speed of the animal as it is running around in the environment. And that's shown here. So these are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 different cells, each shown in a different color. On the x-axis, you have time, 2 minutes, and you see the variation in the firing rate of those cells. And in the background, in gray, you have the speed of the animal as it varies across those 2 minutes. And what you can see, for example, if you focus on the yellow one, is that these cells follow very, very closely the speed of the animal. So it's almost like really a speedometer that tells the rest of the network how fast the rat is moving. And that's just shown here. So these are 12 different cells. None of them really have any preference for a location in the box. Therefore, it's color all over. And to the right here, you see the firing rate. That means the activity as a function of speed. And you can see that all of these have a quite linear relationship to speed. That means that the faster the rat is running, the more they're firing. So in that network, then, you have multiple types of cells. You have the grid cells, which are a kind of coordinate system, tells about directions and distances. You have the border cells, which tell about the local boundaries. You have the head direction cells, which tell about the direction, like a compass. And you have the speed cells, which are necessary for the network to be updated in relation to how fast the rat is moving in it. So, and then you may wonder, is this just in rats or mice? No, that's not the case, because they have been found across several mammals that are quite distant on the phylogenetic tree. So first rats and mice here, but then a few years later, then Nachum Ulanovsky's group found them in bats, and bats are not small rats and not small mice, but they're on a completely different branch. And still they have grid cells with very much the same properties as rats and mouse grid cells. And then they were found in monkeys and in humans with somewhat different properties. I'm not going into that, but still enough similarity to suggest that this is actually a property of the whole of the mammalian brain, regardless of where you are on the phylogenetic tree. So that was the introduction. So now let's move on to some more specific questions. And maybe before... it's okay. I don't want to miss the last part. That's important. But I'll try to. How much time do I have left? Approximately, it's half an hour, 20 minutes. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. So I'll say a few things about the similarities because now you have seen that there are two types of maps. It's the placental map in the hippocampus. And there's the map in the entorhinal cortex, which contains both the grid cells and border cells and everything else. So they are different in one way, and that is that the entorhinal map is very, very rigid. It's one map that's applied all over again all the time, whereas the placental map is actually very, very flexible. So let's begin with the entorhinal map. So I said that different grid cells have different phases. So you see the green, blue, and red one here, so they are shifted relative to each other in one environment. If you now take, and they have, let's say they have this relationship, so the blue one is active to the left of the right, red one, and so on. If you now take the same rat over to a new environment, a different room, and then record again, first of all, you see that the same cells fire are active, and the second thing you see is that they maintain the intrinsic relationship that they had in the other room. So the blue one is still very close to the red one, left to the left of the red one, and above the green one. And again, if you go back. And that turns out to be the case all the time, wherever you go. And this is just an example of a recording, which I won't spend time on this. It's just an example that actually shows that this rigidity of just having one map applied everywhere includes also border cells and head direction cells. They all just have one configuration that's used over and over again. So the question we asked, and now we are over to some of the new data, is if it is true that this is one rigid map that is applied everywhere, then Does it also apply in states when we actually don't explore any space? And sleep is one example. Could you actually consider that there is one map that that even is expressed when we are sleeping? And there's two types of sleep, just to remind, slow wave sleep is the type of sleep that goes on most of the time. REM sleep corresponds to dream sleep in humans. So what Richard Gardner, a postdoc in our lab, did was to start recording from grid cells first in the awake state, so again, the same boxes as before, and then he looked at pairs of cells. So this is a pair of cells, two different cells, that have firing fields that are very, very highly overlapping, so they are in phase. You can see that the dots here are actually more or less on the same location. And this is just same shown here in colors. So what he showed then, which is obvious, because we see here that they're overlapping, is that if you cross-correlate them in time and show how the activity of one cell is correlated to the activity of the other cell, what you then find is that there's a peak at 0 seconds. And because that simply means that when one cell is active, the other cell is active too, like you see here. But the point is, if you now do the same when you go to sleep, slow wave sleep here, you see the same peak. So I mean the cells that were active here together are also active together here. And if you do the look at opposite pairs, like here, these are out of phase. I mean they are fire in different places. You can see, for example, that this one is active in the corner here, this one is not, it's shifted down. Then if they are out of phase, and this also shows they are out of phase because they are dip here, when you go to the sleep state, there's a similar dip that means that they remain out of phase. And then you can plot that for all of the cells pairs that we have. This is 1,267 cell pairs from a number of animals. And what you then see here is this is the left plot here is just a collection of these cross correlations from the open field. That means the awake environment when it was walking around. And a color shows high correlation. The yellow is high correlation and black is low correlation. And then they are sorted from high correlation to low correlation. So no surprise here because some cells are highly correlated cell pairs and some cell pairs are low or are anti-correlated. But the point is, if you now go to the sleep stage and look at the same cell pairs, you see that those that are highly correlated here are also highly correlated in sleep. Those that are not highly correlated are not highly correlated here either. So there is a strong match between the sequence of correlation here and the sequence correlation there. And if you do that in the other type of sleep, REM sleep, when you're dreaming, you find exactly the same thing. It's just less data because it's much less time spent in this state, but you see the same pattern again. So this suggests, or is consistent with the fact, with the idea that the grid cells actually are the result of the way that the network is coupled. And this is ideas that are around are maybe the dominant model of actually how grid cells are produced. It's based on work that much of which is derived actually from work that comes here from Jerusalem with Sompolinski and his colleagues, Amit and Gutfreund, and also followed up now, also Joran Burak is working on the same. So the idea is that this is the result of a rigid network structure, and then that you get the same types of patterns, regardless of whether the rat actually is behaving in the environment, and so on. Good. So I will then move on to the hippocampus, where the places are, because those are totally different. So what you see in the hippocampus is the following. So I'll introduce you to one experiment that illustrates it. So this is an experiment where a rat actually goes through a sequence of many, many environments, many, many rooms. We call it room F1, familiar room here, and then novel 1, novel 2, novel 3, novel 4, 5, 6, 1, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, and then back to the familiar room. So we asked, the place cells that you record in each of these environments, how similar are they? So what we did was to just record all the place cells in each environment, put them on top of each other in a stack, and then correlate the whole thing, and then cross-correlate all the different rooms with each other. And the correlations are then color-coded so that high correlation is red and low correlation is blue. And what you see is, of course, you see red along the diagonal because that's when you correlate the room with itself. But what you will notice here is that almost all cross-correlations are in the very, very deep blue range, meaning that the activity, the place fields patterns that you have in one room are completely uncorrelated with the place field patterns you have in a different room, with the exception, with a few exceptions, those with stars here. And those with the stars here are those occasions when you actually repeated a room. Then you get a high correlation. So it's just when you come into a new room, then it chooses a completely new pattern. So this is a phenomenon that was called remapping already in the 1980s by Bob Muller and John Kuby. But what we have shown with this work, this is the work of Charlotte Almer, who did this in 2014, it shows actually how each map that you have in each different environment in the hippocampus is completely different from the map that you have in another environment, which is then very, very different from what you see in entorhinal cortex, because what you see with the grid cells is that it's one map that's applied over and over and over again, regardless of where you are. In the hippocampus, you have multiple maps, one for each place, which are very, very different. And that's exactly what you may want if you, first of all, if you want to have a metric for space, like grid cells might be, because you want to use the same metric everywhere. You don't want to invent a new metric for every single place. And it points to back to what the hippocampus actually is mostly known for, namely a role in hippocampus. So this brain area has been known to have a role in memory for many, many decades. And if you, for each environment, then actually have a spatial map that is very, very different from anyone else, and then that's exactly what you need to actually store, to not mix up memories, not mix up locations.
Good. So I'll then skip the next one, just in the interest of time, and then go over to the second new part. So this is the second, and there's a third one coming at the end. So the second one is about the development of this system, because is this an innate system, innate, or is it actually a result of experience? So this is the work of Flavio Donato, who is a postdoc in our lab, mostly. So, but first, some background. Place cells, border cells, head direction cells are present as early as it is possible to record them in rat pups, and that is at the age of approximately 16 to 17 days. Then they can actually go out of the nest and begin to explore around. And what you can see is that, by and large, these cells are in a mature state. There's some instability in the place cells, but largely these cells have an adult-like pattern all from the beginning. But there is one exception, and that's the grid cells. The grid cells have a grid-like pattern from the beginning, from this, day 16, but it is very not very regular, and it actually reaches an adult state only at about 3 to 4 weeks or 5 weeks of age, so it's much slower to develop. So we wonder then, what is actually going on? What is the maturation that goes on that makes this go so slow? So then what Flavio Donato did was that he looked for markers of maturational state of cells in this brain area, hippocampus and entorhinal cortex, used the protein double cortin, which is a protein that is expressed only in developing neurons and then is downregulated once they reach a mature state. So he then used antibodies to identify neurons and then antibodies to identify double cortin in the same cells. So here are four example cells, and then counted by automatic procedures the ones that have double cortin. A double cortin then means that it's an immature neuron. And to validate his procedure, he did this first in adult animals, where we know that there's one brain area that has immature cells, and that's the dentate gyrus, as part of the hippocampus. And as expected, he finds that in this particular area, approximately 5% of the cells are immature,
which is exactly what we expect because we know that there are newborn cells in this brain area. But in all other areas, there was basically nothing as expected in an adult brain because everything already has reached the adult state. So what he did then was that he now looked at the development of the hippocampal circuit from day 5 of life up to the 30th day approximately. And he took one area of the circuit at a time. So what you now see here is the same circuit I showed you several times. And then let's begin with the first step here, which is the what we call the medial entorhinal cortex layer 2. That's the beginning of the circuit. And what he finds here, this is a cumulative plot, so the fraction of mature cells, those that do not have double cortin, what you see is that that increases and reaches a stable state, so almost all cells are mature by the age of 14 to 15 days. So that's the first one to mature. Then the next one is another type of cell in this brain area, and it's CA3 here, comes on a few days later. And then comes the next one, CA1, is the next step here in the circuit, comes on the red curve here. Then comes yet another one called subiculum here, this is the yellow one here. And then comes the deep layers where it gets back into entorhinal cortex, comes even a little bit later. And finally, there's an area called lateral entorhinal cortex, which is extremely slow to develop. But what you see here is a staggered development where you take one step at a time, and each one actually over a period of as much as 2 weeks develops one after the other. And since this is a staggered development, then the obvious question is, are these stages dependent on each other? So what he did then was that he blocked activity, for example, in the first stage. So did it in the following way. So he injected on the first day of life, at postnatal day 1, a virus into the medial entorhinal cortex, the area that has the grid cells and so on, that caused the expression of an artificial receptor, HM4D, in cells only in that area. And that artificial receptor was not targeted or activated by any of the natural ligands or transmitters in the brain. But then what he did afterwards was to implant mini pumps on the mouse. And those were then implanted at the 14th day and then remained active for 6 days until the 20th day and just pumped a ligand into the brain called CNO, which is specific or targets this artificial receptor and actually turns the cells off. So all of the cells that then contain this receptor are turned off for this area. So this is a way then to turn off the first step here, medial entorhinal cortex layer 2, and then see what happens to the rest of the circuit. And what you can see is the result here. So in black, you have the proportion of mature cells, and at the early part of the sequence, all of them are mature, and then it decreases, as I said. But what you see here is if you silence the first step, then nothing further matures. It blocks the whole maturation of the rest of the circuit. If you then perform that maturation at the later step in the hippocampus, then everything after that is blocked, as you see here. If you do it at the very end in what's called the lateral entorhinal cortex, only that area is blocked from maturation. And then he even showed that within the entorhinal cortex, there is a type of cell called stellate cell. That's the cell that has to be active. If you block that cell, then you block the whole rest of the circuit. If you block the other type of cell there, which is called pyramidal cell, nothing happens. And he is able to target these cells because they are born at a very early stage of embryonic development. So it's a way to address, to target just those cells. So this, what this shows is that this circuit, the whole hippocampus and entorhinal cortex, actually develops or matures in a stage-wise manner where one circuit, one sub-circuit comes after the other, begins with what is called the stellate cells in the medial entorhinal cortex. So those are, many of those are actually the grid cells. Then comes other cells, CA3, CA1, and so on in the hippocampus. And then the circuit is completed by going back here only 2 weeks later. You get a loop and the thing is finished. And that completion of the loop coincides with the time when you actually get grid cells here, suggesting that you actually need the whole circuit here with the loop through the hippocampus for grid cells to reach their adult-like state. But I think what all this illustrates is that the brain is accessible after all. The barrier that traditionally has existed between physiology and psychology is being broken down now, and I actually think we are on a good way in neuroscience to get to the point where we actually can describe simple behaviors and even complex cognitive behaviors as the result of interactions between thousands or even millions of neurons in the brain. So I think that's where we are, but I should stop, conclude by saying that this is really the work of more than 100 people, some of them present today and some of them are now in other places of the world. So I mentioned specifically the work on object vector, landmark vector cells with Øyvind Høydahl, Richard Gardner, who did the sleep work, and Charlotte Almer, the remapping hippocampus, and Flavio Donato, the development work, and then Maybrit Moser on all of it, and also the early work on grid cells, which particularly involved Marianne Fien, Torkel Hafting, and Sturla Molden, and also important collaborations, especially with Menno Witter, an anatomist, and whom we have interacted with for 2 decades, and also a number of others who have been part of the center for many years. So with that, I'm sorry if I went over time, but it's been a pleasure to talk to you, and thanks again for the kind invitation.
Thoughtful and amazing. And
oh, thank
we
you.
Are delighted to have you here. And now the ceremonial part. So we want Professor Itamar Vilner and myself, we want to bestow upon you the Einstein Medal. And also the scroll, the Einstein scroll. Now, the scroll has inscriptions.
Oh, in Hebrew.
In Hebrew and English. And it says, inter alia, that this occasion serves to commemorate Albert Einstein, the man and his accomplishments. In the spirit of Albert Einstein, Edward I. Moser has enriched science and society in many ways. So the scroll has drawings of the pomegranates, which mark plenty, and the candelabra, the menorah, which denotes knowledge and light, a sign for science and academy. So, thank you very much. It was okay. It was our pleasure, delight, and thank you for being with us.
Thank you so much.